conversation between Anjali Joseph and the conversation will be led by Amrita Narayanan. Thank you so much for being here. Anjali Joseph's third novel, The Living, was published this year. Her first novel, Saraswati Park, won the Betty Trask and Desmond Elliott Prizes at the Vodafone Crossword Book Award for Fiction. The second novel, Another Country, was longlisted for the Van Asian Literary Award. Amrita Narayanan is a clinical psychologist based and writer based in Goa. She is the author of A Pleasant Kind of Heavy and Other Erotic Stories, and of essays, non-fiction psychoanalytical essays on women and sexuality. Over to you.
Thank you. Do some of you who are in the back would like to come forward, perhaps? Or not, as you please. So, Anjali, your most recent book, The Living, which is what we are here to talk a little bit about today, it deals with two characters, both of whom are having a very hard time initially with the process of living. So I thought we would let the audience get a taste for that by having you read a little bit. Start with maybe with the first couple of pages.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
So there are these two characters. One is a woman in her 30s who's a single mother. She lives in a small English town called Norwich, and she works in a shoe factory. And this is the first chapter, the book starts with her.
A conversation between Anjali Joseph, and the conversation will be led by Amrita Narayanan. Thank you so much for being here. Anjali Joseph's third novel, The Living, was published this year. Her first novel, Saraswati Park, won the Betty Trask and Desmond Elliott Prizes at the Vodafone Crossword Book Award for Fiction. The second novel, Another Country, was longlisted for the Van Asian Literary Award. Amrita Narayanan is a clinical psychologist based and writer based in Goa. She is the author of A Pleasant Kind of Heavy and Other Erotic Stories, and of essays, non-fiction psychoanalytical essays on women and sexuality. Over to you.
Thank you. So, Anjali, your most recent book, The Living, which is what we are here to talk a little bit about today, it deals with two characters, both of whom are having a very hard time initially with the process of living. So I thought we would let the audience get a taste for that by having you read a little bit. Start with maybe with the first couple of pages.
So there are these two characters. One is a woman in her 30s who's a single mother. She lives in a small English town called Norwich, and she works in a shoe factory. And this is the first chapter, the book starts with her. This morning I couldn't open my eyes. It was light, mind you. Sunrise is that early now. But I wasn't waking up. The alarm went at 5:45, so I could have tea, roll a fag, look at the sky, put on the radio quiet, take a shower. I left cereal on the table for Jason and some food. It'd be there when I got home. Getting back at 5, it's so hard to imagine, like a place at the end of a walk across fields, a river, a bridge, a forest, hills, and a motorway. It's a long way from the morning till the end of the day, a long, long stretch. Late, I flew down Plumstead Road and up the inside way. My hair was wet, I was breathing too fast. By the time I came up the hill, the cathedral spire behind me turned into the factory shop and hurried through the gate. It was 7:30. The morning had got brighter, real daylight. I came through the first door and the second, up the little slope, through the double doors, hurried to my table, put away my bag, and sat looking calm, trying not to breathe hard as the first bell went. From the corner of my eye, I saw Jane's head move. She was stood talking to John near the heel attacher, but her hair swung as she turned towards me. I put my head down and started checking the first box of Audrey, a vintage slingback with a bow on the band. I got out my black wax stick and fixed a scuff on the toe. The roughing machine was on now, and that first smell of leather was in the air, sweaty and sweet and sharp from the spray the men use on the blasting machines. The windows at the closing end were bright, but high up and far away. The lights were on, they're always on, and it was warm like it always is from the machines, and there was the sound of the machines, the humming. I carried on checking the shoes, making sure they paired, and writing down how many times I'd done it. When I heard the radio and other people's voices, and felt everyone around me at their machines or their station, a Jane moving around to check on things, and that busyness that always is, the shoes move around all of us, a busyness where each one is doing the same thing over and over, but fast, enjoying being able to do it smoothly, but thinking to or in another place. And it was like I'd always been there, never left, never gone home or done anything else, and that's how it always is.
So there's a sense of such stillness and yet camaraderie in this working environment. And Claire was the character that we just read about. Her character develops with this deep sense of melancholy across the first couple of chapters. And then something starts to shift in the third chapter, which is entitled A Person Who Can Be Looked At. And this is when we introduce a little more fully to Claire's son. So could you talk a little bit about the parent-child relationship and how you were elaborating upon that in this book?
So we were talking about this earlier, that I guess there's a lot of grief in the book, and it's one of the big engines of that grief, or the fuel of it, is this feeling of two characters who have not been very satisfactorily parented. I mean, their experience of being a child has been sad in some ways. But the way in which this is restored to them is not really that they heal that relationship with the parent, but more that their experience of parenting someone else is more satisfactory overall. So I think that's I wasn't really sure when I started writing this character. I initially thought maybe I would make her a really bad mother, kind of resentful, and that the things that had happened to her would carry over. And then just as I began to write it, I just found that wasn't the case. There was this really nice friendship actually between her and her son.
You speak of discovering the characters as opposed to creating them. Could you speak a little bit more about the writing process and how you discovered these particular characters, choosing a shoemaker and a chapelmaker as your central characters?
It wasn't really, it's never a conscious choice, so I guess I get these flashes, if you like, of seeing these people and then just find out more about them by spending time with them, by writing lots of things that don't go into the finished book. And that's what happened here. I had this image of a guy making chapels, and I didn't know anything about him, and I had this image of this woman. I knew that she made shoes, and I had an image of her. There's a small, very old forest in Norwich called Lionwood, which appears sort of tangentially in the book. I had an image of her walking through that forest. So that's where I started, and then I just kind of found out more, I guess.
Kept walking.
Yeah, exactly.
So speaking of images, the character of Arun is introduced with actually a dream image, and this is something that Anjali does in all her books. The dreams of the characters are very central to their life experience and to the narrative process. So I wonder if you could read from Arun's introduction and the dream that brings him into the story for us.
So this is where we meet Arun for the first time, and the chapter is called A Small Temple. During the time when I was drinking, I had dreams of great color and violence. I didn't always remember them, but I believed knowing that something had been happening, like sleeping in a room where the television has been on. There was one I had regularly. Sometimes it was in the hall of a railway station, a big one, like CST in Mumbai. Under the arches and pillars, it felt like a maidan. I was on the ground watching people pass. I saw their calves, the men's thin and dark, with sandals at the end, or heavy rubber chappals, and the women's legs emerging from a 9-yard sari, sometimes a regular sari, a girl's legs in jeans, toe rings on her feet. The steps crossed and recrossed, without anyone colliding, even when it seemed they must. And I watched now one pair of feet, then another, waiting for them to stop or clash, but they only went on. The sound of the steps was regular and organic, like rain. This morning again I had the dream. This time it was in the courtyard of the old Rajwada. People came and went, passing and crossing one another, and I was at the side where the Balkan sellers sit with their new well-made hands, or the old woman inside the gate with her basket of flowers. I woke not remembering who I was or where, still looking for all those feet. The metal at the top of the bed was cold, the room was damp and dark. I thought of a shower of a green vegetable field with a small temple at the end. I saw myself bending to pray at the lintel, hardly seeing the surrounding fields as rain smudged them out. But I wasn't in a field of cucumber vines, I was here in the city. At the other end of the room, the cat was watching me. I cursed silently and got up.
I'm just realizing that the dream has this, the temple and the cucumber vines, it foreshadows something that happens later in the book. Okay. So tell us more about how you're using the dream. It's using you.
It's interesting, and maybe it takes someone who thinks so much professionally about dreams to bring this out, but I feel guilty writing about dreams because I have this, this French writer from the 17th century, he said, you know, you should never tell anyone your dreams, it's the most boring possible thing you can do. And I sometimes feel like one should avoid writing about dreams for that reason, or they can be used in an obvious way, but the dreams that I use, they're not really reducible. It's not like a dream means X or Y. I suppose they are a way of admitting the kind of the numinous that exists in a character, and the things that remain mysterious even to the people who know the character really well, even to the character himself, even to me actually. I mean, they're apparent, but they're not reducible to something simple.
So you mean, for example, the temple at the cucumber vines is a place that he's been to and that the reader will see later on, but we'll never know the meaning of those feet that are walking by him?
Maybe there isn't one meaning. We talked about this yesterday, but Wittgenstein says that one of his problems with Freud is that why does a dream have to mean something? If you dream about cherry blossom, why does it have to mean that you miss your father or whatever? Maybe it's also a dream about cherry blossom, because in the dream that's what you experience. And I think both are true. Maybe both can be true.
And what is it here?
I guess it's an experience, it's an emotion. Maybe an emotion not from everyday lived life, maybe an emotion from some other life, earlier life, or maybe something else. And it also of course, you know, he's a shoemaker, of course he'll notice people's shoes and feet and stuff like that.
Maybe it's a way of looking back in a sense.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So to sort of traverse that theme a little further, can you speak about how each of the characters looks back upon their lives? So we have Claire, who's 35, which is not that old, but at the same time, still with a substantial part of life behind her, and then Arlo, who's in his 60s, I think. So can you talk a little bit about looking back into the past and what it means for each of them?
I think with Claire, it's this very kind of English working class narrative, and so she's, and this is like the people that I met when I was researching the book, in a shoe factory, these are people who are stoical, they're not self-indulgent, so and they're busy. So the past exists and traumas exist, but it's not really something that they would go and massage in their private moments. You know, these things are there, and they're moments of rigidity or moments of being stuck, but there's also humor and practicality about how they're addressed in terms of experience. So for her, you know, she had a relationship when she was in her teens, and then she had this son when she was 16, and that's kind of shaped her life. But it's both something, or she had this relationship with her mother, that's something that's there, but it's also, it's just there, like it's a piece of furniture, or like you have a limp or something like that. It's not going away, but it's not something that you're going to cry about every day. And for Arun, it's much more discursive. He's a person of words and thoughts, and there's a very kind of circular rhythm to how he experiences things. And it's almost as though each time he traces one of these mental circles, he goes back to something, and some more kind of light is shed on it, but maybe not completely.
It sounds like for each of them, looking back is also related to how they grieve. And you open your book with a quote about grieving, and I wonder if you would read that for us and maybe talk a little bit about where it came from and what it means to you.
Yeah. So I didn't sort of start with this quote, but I took a quote out of, it's an English translation from the Gita, and it says, it's from it too, it says, the wise grieve neither for the living nor for the dead. And I was training to be a yoga teacher last year in an ashram, and we were reading the Gita, this sentence leapt out of me because I had a chapter titled The Living, and I was thinking about the book, and we decided to call it that and stuff. So, and I guess the perspective that this remark comes from, Krishna says it to Arjuna in the Gita, the perspective this remark comes from is kind of, once you're enlightened, if you like, you can, everything is sort of okay. Everything that happens is okay. There's nothing to grieve for, right? Because you're not, you don't need a specific version of things to happen. Things just keep happening and it's fine. And my feeling is that in some ways I'm very interested in that perspective. But then in other ways, I'm a human being and things happen and I have emotions and there's that sense of the struggle, which is something that Arun talks about. He says, life is, you know, it's the living we should grieve for, it's not the dead, because it's harder to be alive than it is to die. And I guess I'm interested in the kind of tension between these two things. In some ways, you look back on your life, you have that sense of detachment, and you can see that stuff doesn't really matter in the way that you believed. And in another way, it does matter, you have to go through it. So I think that's the stuff of art, otherwise they would just have produced like an inspirational coffee mug or something, with "don't worry" on the side, I guess, I don't know.
Well, as a reader, I think what really jumps out, at least for me, is that there's a lot of hopelessness in the books, and each of the characters is deeply grieving aspects of their lives that are unfulfilled. And particularly for Arun, you feel like, well, this is not really going to work out any different for this guy, because of his age and because it's so entrenched in the Kolhapur district and the kind of occupation he has. But at the same time, there seems to be something that each of the characters comes to about, you know, well, maybe it's okay to be hopeless at some moments in time, and I still have this peaceful moment or that.
I think it's also, it's got its funny moments, like it's probably the funniest book that I've written so far. And that humor is sometimes just the simple humor of either things going terribly wrong or understanding the difference between what you're saying to yourself and what you're doing. I mean, even with Arun, he's quite a nagging individual and he has all these complaints and he's like, you know, everyone else should just accept me the way I am and they should just correct their faults. So there's this lack of self-awareness. I think that's at least some of the comedy of it. So, I think, and it's true for all of us. You can be at your most self-pitying place and that can be the moment in which actually you kind of makes you laugh. Or the most terrible thing can be the most funny thing.
Say more about the humor part, because this is not a book that made me laugh especially, but now that you're elaborating it in this way, I'm starting to think a little bit differently. It was kind of the humor of occupying this selfish person's life.
Yeah.
What was it like for you, writing about somebody who's a bit callous, you know, he sort of doesn't really care about his wife except as someone who can be helpful to him, someone who can be a comforting object to him?
I don't think that's true. That's not my vision of it. I think he's very attached to her, but
I guess what I'm asking is, what was it like to be Arun in those moments, in those moments where he's kind of callous?
I found it fun, actually, and I think he's a sort of, it's such a personal response, and I wouldn't argue anyone into feeling the way that I do, or that, you know, other people that I know who've read it have responded to it, but something about being, he is selfish, he's unself-aware, particularly.
Mm-hmm.
And that was kind of fun, actually. It was kind of fun to write that, and it was fun to inhabit that voice, because I guess I've sometimes experienced being with somebody like that and finding it complicated and frustrating or whatever. It's kind of fun to be on the other side of it and feel what it's like to be that person. And he has his upsides also. I mean, there are many, there are good things about him too. He's not kind of letting go or giving up or being. He tries. He's really trying. He's doing his best. Yeah.
One of the things that stands out about Arun's character is the fact that he's alcoholic or has been alcoholic, and I really love the way you describe that process. It seemed very true. So I wonder if you read a little bit from one of those sections. There's a part in which he ends up falling off the wagon and having a drink with his friend or brother. Maybe you could read a little bit from that.
Okay.
So we can see how our own alcohol and other relationships relate to each other.
This is where he goes back to. He grew up in a really small town called Miraj, which is not so far from Kolhapur. And this is where he goes back to this town for a wedding. Yeah. And he meets his childhood friend who hasn't seen him for a while. I don't know, it's 30 pages long, so where do you think I should read? Oh, 208. So Rachel found two plastic chairs and was sitting on one. Here, he said with a grin. He also had a bottle and near it a rag. I threw back my head and laughed. Trouble was on its way towards me and it was going to be impossible to resist. So this is where you keep your stash. The owner is a friend, Suresh said. Sit down. They're sitting at the back of the garage, the place where cars are repaired. I sat in the chair. Well, I said, this is better than the wedding, although we can't stay long. I must get back before anyone thinks about where I am. I heard the seal of the bottle being broken and he passed it my way. Oh, I said. The moonlight fell across the clear plastic, the yellow label, the fluid inside. I smelled solvent and oranges. It doesn't matter if you normally do or not, Suresh said. Today is today. We haven't seen each other since whenever, but now we're both here. You have a drink with me. I looked at him, the earnest eyes which were unchanged, and the face which was creasing like brown paper. I nodded. The air smelled of flowers and petrol. The back of the mechanic's shop gave onto a ditch, then a field. I miss the countryside, I said. I don't even think about it. And then when I'm here, I took a sip of the sangria. It was the same, more like solvent perhaps than I'd remembered, and as aggressively orangey. I passed the bottle to Suresh and immediately felt possessive, as though he might not give me my fair share. Relax, I told myself. You're just drinking to keep him company. He lifted the bottle. Good to see you. It's good to see you too, I said. I looked at the lights on our left, an occasional car passing, and heard the big road out of sight, the sounds of a nighttime field, crickets and other insects, the trilling of a small bird, the grass breathing. The air was soft and cool on my skin. Suresh gave a big sigh and a small burp. Hey, I said, this sighing, I started with that too. What is it? He shook his head. I don't know, he said, and chuckled. What have we become, I said. The bottle was in my hand now. I took a much less cautious draught, coughed and laughed. I wiped my face and handed back the bottle. I didn't think we'd be like this, I said. I thought we'd be more something. He laughed. More what? I don't know, we had all those games, explorers, do you remember? I remember, he said. I looked at his small, slightly plump hands with their tapering fingers. And felt endeared to him in the old possessive, dismissive way. I wanted to push him for no reason, but also put my arm around him and protect him from the world. The bottle returned. I drank. I thought, I said, that we'd go into the world when we were older, do things. Suresh looked ahead, thought. Why did we have to go out? It's all one world. We were right there in it. But it didn't feel like that, I said. We were protected, shut away. We were children, he said. He accepted the return of the bottle. It was now half full. I looked at it a little sadly. I was nicely warm inside. There's another bottle, he said. Oh no, I said, I won't drink so much. This is just catching up. They do drink so much, obviously. Yeah. In case you're wondering.
By the time it comes around to the next bottle, he's snatching. talk to us about you know, the idea that Arun was alcoholic. How did that come to you, and where were you when it came to you? Because I sort of imagine that when you go to Kolhapur and see how people live there, that the idea of drinking as an escape, it's probably very salient in that context.
I mean, lots of Kolhapuri troublemakers are sort of, what did someone say to me when I was researching? He said, you know, people don't necessarily, they're not drunk, they're not like really, really drunk, but they're just always drinking a little bit to take the edge off the day, as it were. So, people are drinking a lot. I guess that juxtaposition of drinking, which kind of detaches you from what you're doing, and having such a constrained life and working and having, you know, using your hands and being so focused in one way on your work, I think that was interesting. Mm-hmm.
So it was after you went there that you realized that Aaron was going to be alcoholic?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And how did you, what did you draw upon to sort of make the depictions of his drinking?
I mean, I've been drunk plenty of times. I haven't really had an alcohol problem or anything, but I've been drunk, and that feeling when you're drinking, which I started doing probably in my early teens in England, you know, like everyone else around me, when you're drinking and you begin to get a little high and you kind of don't want it to stop, so you carry on drinking more, that kind of thing is, or feeling a little bit possessive about the bottle or whatever. I guess those kind of things, really, just that observation of it.
Yeah, other kind of piece about Aaron's life, other than his drinking, that gives him his outlet is his affair.
Mm-hmm.
Could you speak a little bit about the sexuality and actually for both the characters, maybe if you could talk about, you know, what sex means to them and the way you were thinking about it?
Again, I didn't sort of explicitly discuss this with the people that I met when I was researching, but I felt like it's a little bit different for people who are working really hard and are more working class. Like, sex is not really... Sometimes sex can just be sex, even for the woman, even for the female character. It's not... And she has this kind of brief, transgressive relationship, and nothing bad happens to her after, which is... I like that. You know, that it can... It's also an escape from... If everything in your life is for something else, if you're working so you can earn money, or you're looking after your kids or with your family, then this is one moment where it has no productivity. And that's kind of what makes it so great. In a life where everything is geared towards being productive.
So it's kind of something refreshing because it's not cool.
It's just that it's extracurricular, it's not for anything.
For Claire, there are numerous actual sexual relationships that seem to play some kind of formative role over time. And it's also this very comforting, and you have heard about in bed with another body, that's a recurring theme over and over again. And to me also, I started to have this image of the mother child body.
Oh, okay. Which,
as well as a repeating motif that comes in there. So there's a moment in the book where Claire talks about her childhood sexuality and what it was like, no? Something about adolescence and how you feel like you're the only one going through this crazy experience, but actually everyone is going through it. Just kind of really, it spoke to me because at the time that Claire is having these sexual experiences, her son is also having, starting to come of age and have sexual relationships. And I think it's really extraordinary the way she juggles that.
Mm-hmm.
Very different than how you might expect them in the other cultural context.
Yeah.
So to wind my way around to the question, I was wondering to what extent you were trying to look at two different cultures and two different working class cultures in the process of this book. I know it wasn't intentional as such, but
I don't know if they're even that different. I think it's just that the one is more concealed than the other. So maybe they have a similar view of sex. It's just that for the Indian character, it has to be more. And he's married, she's not married. It's, in that sense, it's very different. But it's that experience of release or whatever. It's kind of common to them both in a way.
Yes, it seems to soften the blow of loss that throughout the just to say it's been and see in what ways and all these themes that we've been talking about play into who you are as a person and how you think about things. So, grief, dreams, juggles. I noticed you're wearing collaborates. And I was, I think at every moment you have this one element of what you are living at that moment.
Sure.
So could you say a little bit about where you were personally at the time that you were with this?
I don't think you have insight on that until some time after the book has been published, maybe a few years actually. I was living in, when I started writing this book, I was living in Norwich, and then I moved back to India probably halfway through, I think. Not because of the book, but I just did. I think for me, it's also actually thinking about death. That was one really simple thing, this book. So, at a certain age, you start thinking, maybe this is halfway through my life, or perhaps much more than halfway, I don't know. And you start thinking, you think about your childhood, you think about the person you are, and just the possibility of, when you're very young, at least for me, there was this feeling that there was time to do everything, like there's time to fix the past and live the future, and all of these things. At a certain point, you kind of go, no, this is it. Like, these are the flaws, and you're going to let go of them or carry them or whatever, or both. So I guess that's why I was interested in writing about these people who look back on their past. And also I wanted to write something in the first person, which felt really challenging. It's not something I've done before. Because there's something about inhabiting a voice in the first person, it's much harder. And so in a way you have to be, I think, less autobiographical than if you were writing in the third person. In the third person you kind of just, you know, it's not me, so you can kind of sneak in a lot of stuff about yourself, honestly. And in the first person it's harder because this person has to really exist. So,
you really have to be someone else.
Yeah, you have to let that person be who they are, yeah. So, I guess a good kind of writing about being a parent, which I'm not, it's not something I've done. I mean, that was also a way of releasing my childhood.
Yeah.
And,
Oh, what I'm hearing also is that maybe your age is one of the things.
For sure, exactly, yeah.
That you're at a certain point where you can actually do it.
And for me, it's a very celebratory thing. Like, I don't feel bad about death. I feel like I remember revising for final exams when I was at university. Basically, the third year exams were the big exams, and that was the whole grade. And so revising for these exams was actually really tedious. And there was this liberation when it got too late to do anything anymore. And that's kind of how I feel about death. I feel like, you know, good. Like, it'll be nice not to have to think about it. So I don't think it's like a bad, you know, I don't have a Woody Allen feeling about death, like if you're gonna die, what's the point of anything? I'm kind of like, oh good, you know, the fact that there is a cutoff period, I think is kind of a happy thing. So thinking maybe you're halfway through your life or suddenly a big amount through your life, for me that's actually quite liberating. Like you don't have to sit there and chew over things anymore.
Are you saying that the presence of the awareness of death makes the living different?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah,
it is. I don't know. It's so obvious to me because that's how I feel. Maybe it's not how most people feel. But if you thought that you were just going to go on forever, isn't that an appalling thought? Like I don't know. For me, it is.
Well, in a lot of the relationships that you portray, certainly in some of the other books, there is a sense of well, we don't have to do anything because, like for example, the relationship between Mohan and Lakshmi in Saraswati.
Yeah.
And it happens in marriages. It's kind of stasis evolves and. Mm-hmm. And there's not a sense of any urgency or need to change
right.
or move, which is, in a way, the myth of going on forever.
Okay, maybe, yeah.
Where you're not really wanting to make any movement or change.
Right.
But you're saying that for you, this awareness of the death is imminent.
Yeah, it's very invigorating, I think.
Yeah. And because it changes the way that you engage.
Yeah, you just don't have to bother about a bunch of stuff anymore,
right?
Well, I guess my exam analogy is the way I feel about it, you know, you're like, there's no more I can do at this point. So, that's liberating, I think. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought maybe you could tell us a little bit about the trajectory or the relationship, if at all, if there is any between your three books from Saraswati Park, another country, and here. The living. Are there any common themes you've been exploring and developing? Is there, how have you transitioned as a writer from one to the next?
For me, the signal thing is one is writing in the first person here, which is feels like a big departure, and one is language. I think when I wrote Saraswati Park, which is quite a nostalgic book and quite idealized, language is something I'm sort of in love with from childhood. But with this book, it's kind of quite spare, and I don't really want to use language. I feel like, as a writer and even as a human being, the less I say, the more I kind of transmit, and I experience this more and more. So I sort of wanted the story or the feeling or the people to be there almost under the surface of language, and language to be doing very little, which is sort of a very contradictory thing to say, even at a logical level, a nonsensical thing to say, but I think it has some meaning.
It's been a process of discarding language along the way. And it sounds like what you also said is that as you went through this process of discarding language, the plot somehow arrived in a different form. It does feel like the interior life of the characters is so much more salient than the plot in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really write super plotted books anyway, to be honest. Yeah, there's a different relationship to everything in this book because it's so interior, so it's not, there's not much obligation to kind of recap anything in a logical way or, you know, go through things in a linear fashion or anything like that. It's just things as they arise in the moment. And they have their own reality. I mean, the memory that you feel, the memory that you go back to today is something that you create today in some way. It's not actually something from 1984 or whatever.
I thought that was really unusual structurally about this book, that you relied on inner memories and inner landscapes so strongly versus exterior ones relative to your first book.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll open it up for questions to see what everybody wants to say.
I was wondering about the language bit. I appreciate the fact that you've discarded the usual fluff that most fiction hides behind. For example, the analogies and the similes that usually writers take up. I remember in my book is about professions which are dying out, and most of the times I'm interviewing simple people from everyday lives. And the language that they speak in is so simple, and these are all, I'm recording their interviews. In parts of the book, I felt like I could compulsively add some intelligent bits and some analogies and some similes to make it seem like a stronger language. So how easy was it for you to do it? Did it feel like risk?
No, it didn't feel like risk. When I think of the experience of spending time with people who were working in this shoe factory or the chappal makers, I felt like these people actually had a very, I wouldn't say it was poetic, but a very, a little like Karan was talking earlier about how in Hindi there's a kind of, this is not how he put it exactly, but there's a saltiness, a kind of direct engagement with life and death and brutal things. And that's kind of what gives the spoken language its flavor. It's sort of not afraid to touch something, you know. And I feel like that is true of the way that working class people are. Or for anyone, the less you say, the more meaningful those things become, right? The more resonant those things become. And the more you're listening to a person who doesn't speak English. So there's more presence in those words. And I feel that really works. Like it doesn't, and it's still quite figured, it's quite literary, the language of this book, actually. I wanted the thing under the words to be the thing that was felt, not just the words.
How easily did the editors take to it?
I mean, that was fine. That wasn't really a problem. I guess I've been quite lucky actually with editors on the whole. I basically do all of my own editing at a certain point. With this book, I had the complication that it was sold before it was written, and so I sent drafts to people, and that all got very confusing for everyone. It's not really something I even wanted to do, and I wouldn't do it again. But otherwise, it's not something I have had conflicts with people about. I mean, so I've been lucky.
Yeah. So, I was listening to you read. I mean, it seemed to you are a very good master service. Machines in the first part, and then there was the button bars at the station, and the sort of patient description of two men drinking. So I was wondering, now that you've written three books, have you tried to evolve a method of noticing as you're living your daily life? Do you keep notes, or do you like operate solely from memory? This journalists, of course, will document things pretty aggressively, right? Like you have to know how to describe a room. You have to be very accurate about the shape of something. Take notes. For novelists, especially realists, people are realists, like operate in this middle ground between journalism and memory.
Right.
So how do you evolve sort of a method of living that accommodates those two extremes?
I'm sort of a pathological noticer, actually. So like on a good day, I can notice less because it's kind of overwhelming. So that's been my since childhood. Yeah. So actually, I think I'm just sort of taking out the unnecessary details, but unfortunately, there's like full saturation of noticing stuff all the time. So, yeah.
Is it visual or is it all?
It's often more visual, but I can tune into other stuff. And it's also quite a little bit like what you were talking about. It can be very emotional. I don't really want to, but I easily register the feelings of people around me. I mean, feel them even in some sense. So.
Did you say compulsive noticer?
Yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead.
obstacles writing about it, and you don't know how do you liberate yourself to write about those sorts of things.
Yeah. So the fear is that you write something really corny, right? Like something really bad. How do you liberate yourself?
But also as a woman writing in Indian context, you know, all of those sorts of...
Not just Indian, I mean, this I have noticed, and other people I've talked to have said the same thing. If you're a woman and you write about someone masturbating or someone having sex or something, at a festival or at a meeting, people will kind of, men, will come up to you and they'll be like, oh, so, you write a lot about sex, and they will literally look you up and down at that moment. You know, like, this is not, I mean, if I wanted to just go and pick up somebody, I would just go to a bar. I wouldn't spend 3 years writing a book, that's really laborious. This is not my way of, like, putting myself out there on the table sexually. This is because, actually, this stuff is there for women and men, and it's not that exciting if there's a masturbation scene in Ulysses by James Joyce, published in 1920, but apparently if there's a mention of masturbation in a novel published in 2012 by a woman, that's still kind of exciting, you know. So I don't know, I just decided not to worry about it, I guess. But the main fear for me, and I think Amrita will probably answer this much better, is that you're going to write about sex badly, right? Because it's such a visceral experience, and for me it's not necessarily, if it's going well, it's not an experience where you're narrating anything to yourself or experiencing things verbally. So then to use, I mean, if that's happening, it's not so good. So if you to use words to convey the experience is more complex, I think.
Well, maybe you're watching it in some way.
Yeah.
And then you're watching good sex happening. You're able to,
yeah,
to put words to it and to write about it. I think in terms of the writing, but in the Indian context, as women, and the question that you were asking, I think it's very layered and complicated, complex rather. On one hand, there's this notion that Anjali's talking about where people are turned on or excited sort of somewhat more easily than one would expect. But there's also envy and anger that comes up around women's sexual writing. And I think that's forgotten about, as Anjali said. So I think every writer probably has their way of forgetting about it. For me, it was always going into nature and being somewhere that's away from people. And I think that in a way similar to what Anjali was describing, that one gets to a place where the voices of other people in society, for example, just become less important because you manage to get that far away in your head. So I guess it's about a certain kind of journey, and one can make the argument that living in a culture where, you know, women's sexuality is perhaps not as celebrated, that one gets practiced from a very young age to disappear in your head, to create these sexualities in your mind that are not seen and not known unless you choose to write about them.
That's true. So maybe you're saying that because it's concealed, it has more resonance in some way.
And that concealing it comes sort of naturally. It becomes a safety imperative, I think.
Yeah.
And then it's sort of a great relief to be able to write about it again in the safety of your book and your computer. One doesn't necessarily confront the audience at that point. I think that's how you make it. That's how you do it, I think. Just like you do.
Yeah.
Are there questions? Anyone else?
Okay, well, thank you so much, Amrita.